Hi everyone, my name's Giz Edwards and welcome to my podcast Giz Talks. Today Giz talks to Matt, aka Tifero, a fellow YouTuber and lucid dreaming consultant here on the lovely wonderful website of YouTube. We're going to be discussing many different topics over the course of about an hour, so grab some headphones, listen to us while you play video games or do your morning routine or do some housework, whatever it is you choose to do. And before we get going, I just want to say a big thank you to those of you who are supporting the show on patreon.com/GizEdwards. For a single dollar a month, they're able to get exclusive content, including access to the audio download of this podcast a week before it's aired on YouTube. The first one might be a bit weird because I've only got one guest at the moment. So when that gets built up, then you'll get like consistent content. If you'd like to be a part of the Gizzards, then head over to patreon.com/GizEdwards. And I just realized I'm brandishing a razor in my hand, so let's put that down. Okay, welcome to the very first podcast, Matt.
Thank you.
No problem. Tell the audience who you are, what you do, and, you know, all that jazz.
Okay, so I'm Matt, and as you said, I run a YouTube channel called Tifero, and that channel kind of started off as this mishmash channel of a bit of self-development, a bit of some kind of esoteric, strange subjects, and a bit of lucid dreaming. Over time, it's become more and more focused on lucid dreaming, although I do hope to bring some more self-development content back over the coming months.
Brilliant. So the name Tifero, I've always wondered, where's that come from?
Okay, so this is kind of a funny story. It mostly originates from me being terrible at coming up with names. But as you know, I've made videos on a lot of esoteric subjects and stuff like that. I, some time ago, was interested in tarot, and specifically not in tarot for predicting the future, but in tarot as a way of probing the subconscious, using the symbols on the cards to kind of get answers from your subconscious, much in the way I would do that in a lucid dream. And I wanted to make a blog about this. Blog about this kind of intuitive approach to tarot cards. And I wanted some kind of cheesy sounding name for it. And I had been looking at this thing called the Tree of Life. In the middle of the Tree of Life is this Sephiroth called Tifareth, which is like the heart center of it. And so I came up with this thing that it's tarot from the heart, Tifero. Then I gave up on the blog idea, kind of lost interest in the idea, didn't want to do it. And so when I came to make a YouTube channel, I had no idea what I was going to call the channel. And I was just like, well, I never used that Tifero name. I guess I'll use it.
And well, that's quite handy. Does the blog still exist?
No, I never actually started it in the end.
Oh, I see. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I've always wondered about the name. It's quite a unique name. But now that when you broke it down like that, I kind of do get where that came from. And that's quite, I like the whole concept of from the heart type thing. That's really cool. I guess, so you say that you've made self-development videos in the past and now you focus primarily on like lucid dreaming, I assume. You did start a second channel in which you were going to do primarily self-development and some like meditation thing. Is there any progress with that? Or
basically, I kind of set up that channel as an experiment. I wanted to see, you know, how well it would be if I split up the content over the two channels. And it was working okay and stuff. YouTube started changing all of their things regarding monetization and stuff like that. And I kind of got concerned that as my channel grows, they're going to make all of these restrictions on smaller channels worse and worse. And I thought maybe I should just try and diversify my original channel again. And so I basically stopped making videos on that. And now that's kind of my goal.
Yeah, I assume you're talking about the whole adpocalypse thing that happened. Have you had much negative experience with that? Because I've had some really bizarre videos out of nowhere just be demonetized for no apparent reason. I had one last week, which was, I did a sleep deprivation experiment and it was split up into two different parts, part one and part two. And part two was demonetized, but part one was never. And I don't understand.
Yeah, I think it's like an automatic algorithm doing it. But then the problem is you need to get like a certain amount of views in a certain amount of time to even get it appealed. So I have a bunch of ones that clearly shouldn't have been demonetized that are just sitting there with the yellow dollar icon still.
Yeah, I understand that. I've made a video that as we're recording it, I posted yesterday on YouTube, which is talking about, is there such a thing as justified murder? And I knew straight away that that wasn't going to get monetized. So the way I went around that is I put spaces in between all the letters of murder.
Yeah.
And it worked. So I beat the system. Okay, so yeah, definitely. If there's something that you know that's not going to get monetized, then yeah, it's worth a go. So I suppose the first question I've got for you is, how long have you been making content on YouTube? How long has Tifero, the channel, been around for?
So I made my first video in November 2015. So it's coming up to a little bit over 2.5 years now, something like that.
Okay. Have you always seen yourself as doing something on YouTube?
Well,
before that?
Before I made the YouTube channel, I got to a point in my life, I kind of had a dark period several years ago, came out of that, worked on myself, and realized I wanted to help other people work on themselves. And I started writing, and I was going to go down the book route. And I watched this one guy's video where he's talking about his experiences helping others on YouTube. And I just thought, hey, I'll give this a go. You know, video's not really my thing, but I'll try it out. And I tried it out, and I ended up loving it more than the writing, and basically stuck with it.
That I like that. I like that a lot, because I can kind of understand that process that you went through, because I have always wanted to write a book, but I don't I don't read books, but I've always wanted to get that information out there. So when I was making my YouTube channel, I thought, well, if I concentrate on making lucid dreaming videos, which was what people were liking on my channel, then I can give out information that way without actually having to write a book. And the whole process of making a video, in which you create a bit of content, put it out online, and it's automatically up for review. Like, there's no middleman between you and the consumer, which I particularly enjoyed. If you weren't to do anything self-help related or lucid dreaming related, what kind of content do you think you'd be making?
I guess probably something like gaming videos. There was a time when I was younger, I wanted to make like a gaming channel and that. I think I kind of got put off the idea though, because I kind of felt like if I had a gaming channel, I would want to record all of the games that I'm playing all of the time, and it might kind of take away from the gaming experience sometimes.
I can understand that. Yeah, I can definitely understand that. Any thoughts about pursuing that, maybe?
Well, I did do something not too long ago where I basically took videos where I wanted to just chat for like 15-20 minutes, and I basically had a game going in the background. And
I remember watching a few of those.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking of doing a bit more of that, and you know, I might even start one on the side, just make the occasional gaming video. But I don't think I would put as much time into it as my current channel.
No. I'd have to say, because even though your channel's only been around since 2015, the progress that you've made on YouTube, because what, you're 25,000 subscribers?
Closing in on 31.
Nice. Oh, really? Hell, we jumped up. Yeah, you've definitely made a lot of progress in a very short amount of time. Why do you think that was? Why do you think that?
Well,
specifically for you?
For me, it was because I set some very clear goals right from the get-go. You know, maybe not in the first month or two of YouTube, but probably around the start of 2016, I said that I wanted to reach 1,000 subscribers by the end of the year. And I would do whatever it took. I would make more and more videos. I would look to optimizing my tags, titles, and all that. I would spend lots of time learning. And I did that, and I reached it in August. And since then, I've been setting kind of bigger and bigger goals.
Would you say that YouTube channels, because you've got a good experience with like a newish channel going on, would you say that nowadays it's more difficult to create a channel and have it to be successful than it was like back in 2015?
I'm not entirely sure, to be honest, because, you know, my second channel, you know, I didn't take that far enough to really see where it's going. I do feel like there is room for smaller YouTubers to grow in that. There is obviously an element of luck involved. I got very lucky in that my first ever video blew up completely and brings in 60% of my subscribers still.
Hell, even to this day?
Yeah, even to this day.
What video was that? Was that the...
It was the one with a really kind of not too proud of it, clickbaity title, like how to lucid dream in 5 minutes in a 9-minute video.
Yes, I know. Yeah. I've not got a problem with clickbait as such. I think you remember when I made that video about a certain YouTuber. I won't say because I'll get backlash to hell like last time. I haven't got a problem with people doing clickbait, but it's when the content isn't correct, then it just exacerbates the clickbait even worse.
I think in my case as well, I made that video, I titled it basically, I was just learning about how to title videos properly at that point. And I basically got the idea that if I called it How to Lucid Dream, that's too competitive a keyword. So I have to pick one of these other ones people are searching for. And it's like How to Lucid Dream Instantly, How to Lucid Dream in 9 seconds. And I'm thinking, okay, mild takes about, 5 minutes, repeat the mantra, go to sleep. So I picked that one. And then later it blew up and I'm just like, I'm not touching that title. I'm not touching the description. I don't want it to get re-ranked. I'm just leaving it as it is.
Yeah, I understand that. So I suppose that leads me on to the next question that I've got for you, which is what made you get into lucid dreaming in the first place?
Well, my first lucid dream basically happened spontaneously. I was in a dream. I'm walking through some kind of rundown street in Africa. There's a couple of kids kicking a football around. They kick it to me. I think I kick it back and I walk along and I see this vending machine. It looks really modern and out of place in this place. And I just suddenly knew that I was dreaming. And I wasn't even really familiar with lucid dreaming at this point. I think I'd vaguely heard of it, but I didn't know it existed. I thought it might have just been made up. And here I was in a dream, in control. I go to the vending machine. I was really thirsty, so I got a glass of water from it. It was really refreshing. I woke up and the first thing I thought is just, that was really real. That felt like real life. And that was kind of the kindling of my interest, but it wasn't until I had probably 7 or 8 more of those that I really looked into it and realized that, oh, you can actually have lots of these if you practice it. And so I started practicing it. And after I learned I could do it myself, I basically became hooked and have done it ever since.
That's quite cool. How old did you say that you were when you were doing that?
I believe I was 16 at the time. I believe I was 16.
Okay. That's quite cool. That's quite cool. I like that story because not a lot of people will consider their first lucid dreaming to be something like a sense, like a taste. I think it's one of the ones that's least looked at because, out of all the senses, I think in dreams you look at your visuals and then you look at, well, then you hear, then you feel, then maybe touch and taste, very similar. But for you to have like a refreshing feeling, it's quite interesting for your first lucid dream.
I think that's why it stuck in my memory so well, aside from it being the first, because even now in my lucid dreams and that, unless I go out of my way, sometimes I taste things to help with stability. Like I'll just pick up a glass of something and taste it or eat some food. But other than that, I'm not really doing that very often. And this was just this very strong feeling. I even described it at the time as the most refreshing drink I'd ever had in my life.
Yeah, I had a really weird experience in a lucid dream once where I don't even know if I was lucid, come to think of it, where I needed to... I was at a train station in Penzance where I live, and in this train station probably 15 years ago, there used to be a vending machine on one of the platforms. So I went to the vending machine in this dream, bearing in mind this was probably 3 years ago, and I got a bottle of Coca-Cola from the vending machine and I drank it, and it was probably the nicest tasting thing I've ever drank in my life. And that was just from a dream, which is very, very peculiar. There's going to be quite a few guests that I'm going to have on this podcast, and a lot of them are not going to be lucid dreaming based, but because you're a lucid dreaming consultant, I would say, what would you say is probably your most reliable or most often practiced lucid dreaming induction technique?
Lately I've basically dropped all of the techniques that involve me waking up in the night because I've kind of had some sleep issues over the past year and I just don't want to risk that. So I'm trying to learn to do it all with reality checks. But in terms of the most reliable, the one that I've used the most over the years would be the Dream Exit Induced Lucid Dream.
Okay, yep.
I find that it's sort of like wild, but unlike regular wild where I haven't just woken up from a dream, it's almost guaranteed to work for me. If I've just come out of a dream and it's still fresh in my mind, I can go back into it very easily.
Yeah, I quite agree with that because, like yourself, I've had some really bad bouts of insomnia. I've been experiencing it quite a lot in my life, but recently it got quite difficult to go to sleep and remain asleep. So I, like yourself, try and avoid any techniques that make me wake up purposefully, like wake back to bed, or, you know, if I have to set an alarm, you know, or something like that. So I would say, yeah, Dream Exit Initiated Lucid Dream is pretty solid one to do. How often would you say that you have a lucid dream, or how often, or as well as that, how often do you recall dreams? Like, how many a night?
I recall between, say, 1 and 5 a night currently, I would say. Yeah. As for how many I have per week, I would say between 2 and 4, usually. If I'm, you know, really going into it and like really trying hard for like a month to lucid dream, then I'll probably get, you know, in the region of 20 lucid dreams in that month or something like that. Whereas okay. If I'm kind of dropping back from it, I might just get, you know, a couple a week, and they might be, you know, not so eventful ones.
That's quite interesting. I would say that if you're going at it, and you, what did you say, 20 a month,
mm-hmm.
roughly? Yeah, that's quite a lot, and that's quite a high statistic. What would you say is like an average for like a beginner or someone who's just getting into lucid dreaming?
Well, from what I've seen with students and that, it really, really varies. Like, I've seen some people who, you know, they've practiced for 3 months and then they get their first lucid dream. And then I've seen other people, like my actual first month of practicing, I got really lucky. I had 20 in a month. I've never had that before or since with mild, that many in a month with mild. Mild for me works maybe, you know, a third, a quarter of the time, if that. But in this month, I was basically getting lucid most nights. And there's other people that I've spoken with, students and that have that, and they have amazing dream recall. I think a part of it is just people who've actually had them lucid dreams before in their life, even if it's just a couple in childhood, tend to have an easier time getting into it as a beginner. And so they'll have more often. I think another aspect is actually knowing how to have a dream exit induced lucid dream, because that has been the source of many of the multiple ones I've had, because I can have a lucid dream and then after it ends, you know, I can be in bed for 5 minutes or something and I can go in and have another lucid dream. So I can have more in one night.
Yeah. And I think that's a technique that's underutilized at the moment, because a lot of people will try and, you know, perform like a wake back to bed because it's so popular, but then they forget that if you've woken up from a dream, like say you've done the wake back to bed, you go back to sleep and you wake up again, coincidentally, then that doesn't mean that what you've done is a failure. It just means that you can set up for another attempt at lucid dreaming by doing like dream exit initiated lucid dreams. It's interesting that you say that about people who have had somewhat lucid dreams when they were children find it easier as adults to do that, because I've found the same thing. So with the clients that I've had in the past, a lot of them who have a natural knack for lucid dreaming are kind of the ones that have had an experience in the past when they were younger. Like, take myself, for example. I had my first lucid dream when I was 5, which is very young, but I kind of had that knack, that innate ability to do that just because. And now I'm saying that out loud. I don't know if that's because as an adult, you know, maybe I'm just more predetermined to become lucid than someone else because I had one when I was 5. And, you know, so now I'm as I'm explaining it, I'm kind of unsure about it. Yeah, no, that's some good, good statistics that you've got there.
I actually kind of have a theory about all of that. I kind of have this theory that waking up in a lucid dream, you know, waking up in a dream and becoming lucid is very similar to being present when you're awake. And so I think some people are naturally a bit more present, a bit more in the moment, not on autopilot all the time, and have an easier time at it.
Yeah, I kind of understand that as well, because when I was living in Plymouth, which is a city here in England in the southwest, I would walk around the city centre and I would see these people who were just like experiencing life passively, like they would be kind of like in a zombified state, and I'm thinking there's no spark there, there's no like buzz that they can have in their mind, that the chances of them, if they practice lucid dreaming, would be very slim.
Yeah.
So I think people like yourselves and myself as well, we just, if we're a bit more alert in the waking life, then, you know, it kind of shows, which, yeah, it's a solid theory as well. And I kind of agree with that. Anything to add on lucid dreaming, like with that aspect of, let's say, for a beginner, let's say a beginner's listening, what would you say is the best piece of advice for starting out? If there's something that you wish you knew one bit, what would it be?
I think the main thing that I wish I knew was just to be patient with it all and realize that people progress at different rates and not everyone is going to get, you know, amazing results in their first month, not just with getting lucid, but actually with controlling them. I struggled for a really long time with stability of my dreams. Probably my first 50 plus dreams were over in under 30 seconds. My 50 plus lucid dreams, yeah. And so I was really impatient with that. I kept trying to do all of these fancy things all at once in those dreams instead of focusing on what I needed to focus on, which was actually stabilizing them and getting them to last longer. So for a beginner, okay, I would just say, you know, take it slowly, be a bit patient with it, and focus on where you're at currently.
That's a solid bit of advice. In terms of lucid dreaming, I suppose the next question I've got for you is, what do you think is the next big thing for lucid dreaming, be it a good thing or a bad thing?
So I personally think the kind of next big application specifically for lucid dreaming is in therapy. I think it's one of the easiest places for us to introduce it, because I think therapy is always looking for something new they can try to help people, because right now we don't know how to, you know, just completely cure someone's depression or completely cure someone's anxiety. We just have tools for helping manage it, for helping get people better, but they're not perfect. And I think as someone with social anxiety and so on, I think that just being told certain things in therapy and given some basic activities that you don't really know if they're helping or not doesn't always have the intended result. You know, you don't always feel like you've taken something away from it. But if you can go, for example, into a lucid dream and you can practice something there, you have this real tangible experience. You actually experience that something has happened, this event happened, and you come out of it and you feel like something has perhaps changed. So I think it could be really useful in that aspect.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that. I would say that's probably a really big thing that's being underutilized at the moment. Because I know from the network of people that I've got, are you aware of Max from Team Lucid Dream?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he uses lucid dreaming to help him with his psychosis. And he like hears voices and sees images sometimes, but he's got lots of different voices in his head and he goes into lucid dreams to help him talk to the character of that voice. But I suppose with anything like lucid dreaming for therapy, there's going to be a lot of people, including myself, who will say that if you're in a lucid dream, it doesn't necessarily mean that the thing you're talking to is going to be like, say you've got depression, if you're trying to deal with depression in a lucid dream, that thing that you're talking to in the dream, it doesn't necessarily mean that that is the aspect of depression that you've got. It might just be just a wacky dream thing. So there's a lot of things to consider when it comes to that. But I would agree that lucid dreaming for therapy is a good thing. So I know they're using things like meditation to help with stuff now. So lucid dreaming is not that far-fetched. I mean, it's a little bit far-fetched, but not that far-fetched. Okay, so being on YouTube, you've been a YouTuber for 3 years now. What would you say is your best experience that you've had on YouTube?
Okay, so I'll kind of answer this in two parts. Well, the first part is just the experience of being on YouTube in general. I kind of didn't expect it to be so much fun, such a rewarding experience. And the second part is definitely the viewers and the interactions with the viewers. Like the moment that sticks out to me, this one moment since I started my channel, was when that very first video of mine, I got a comment on it from someone, and the video didn't have that many comments at the time. And I got a comment from someone saying they had their first lucid dream because of it. And I remember thinking, you know, I've had hundreds of these experiences. Some of them have changed my life for the better. And I just realized, hey, I can put out a video and it can potentially lead to someone else having all of these cool experiences, but not just one person, not just 10 people, not 100, but potentially thousands. And that kind of made me realize, wow, you know, YouTube is pretty powerful and I really love it here.
That's a good question. A good answer. Sorry. I know there's a question that I'm going to ask you. It's one of the last questions I'll ask you, which is, where do you see yourself in 5 years' time? But aside from your 5-year goal, your growth on YouTube has been quite quick, as I've mentioned before. Where do you see your channel Tifero going?
Well, I really want it to be a self-development channel as a whole. I want it to kind of cover everything, and particularly the things that I feel are kind of fundamentals of self-development, things like meditation, things like fitness, things like just kind of getting a handle over your own mind, dealing with negative thoughts, dealing with anxiety, dealing with depression, stuff like that. I want to kind of help people get on their own path to basically getting their lives sorted out.
Cool. That's a good thing. All under the YouTube channel Tifero, though, I assume.
Yeah, that's the goal.
Do you find it difficult? Because I know from personal experience that when I post a bit of content that's not lucid dreaming, I get quite a negative response from not just the audience, but from subscribers, because people subscribe to YouTube channels, and when they post a bit of content that's not exactly what they want. So for example, my channel is lucid dreaming based. Because I posted a video called Justified Murder, I got a lot of unsubscribed people. Do you ever find that it's difficult to change what content you put up on YouTube now that everyone knows that you're a lucid dreaming?
Absolutely. That's my biggest struggle with it. That's how I'm currently now, you know, sitting down and trying to think, how can I best do this? So this is why I haven't already done it. I'm trying to introduce things slowly in a way that makes them interesting to my current audience, and also potentially attracts in a new audience interested in that. So for example, I started a meditation series. In the past, I noticed something about my content. I had lots and lots of lucid dreaming videos, and I had lots of self-development videos, but none of the self-development videos were on the same subjects. And so I wasn't really attracting an audience for any of those things. So I thought, if I start a series, that can bring in an audience of people who want to learn about meditation, and then those people will be more likely to watch those videos, and that might help with it.
Yeah, I've gone the opposite route to that. I've just decided to kind of just chop off the rotting limb. So I've just gone with it, and I can predict that over the next couple weeks, it might take a while to, you know, get readjusted to new subscribers, but I predict over the next couple weeks I'll lose quite a lot of subscribers, but it's just the way it is. I don't mind people unsubscribing, because I'd rather have a lower subscriber count and more people watching than a big subscriber count and a smaller percentage of my audience actually watching.
Yeah, I agree. So
I've kind of just gone with it, with the whole changing of the content.
Yeah, I actually saw that video. I watched it probably an hour ago or something like that, where you were talking about the new content you were going to do. And I agree that you kind of just have to go with it, because at the end of the day, you want to attract a certain audience, the audience who want to watch the kind of videos that you want to make. So if you kind of just keep doing something that isn't necessarily what you want to make all your videos about, then you're just going to attract more of the people who want that to be all of your content.
Yeah. And one of the things I'm concerned about is, will I get bored with the content I produce, which is why I don't want to get bored. So I changed it, but you know, that's that. Right. Now there are 8 questions that I have pre-warned you about. These 8 questions I will ask every single guest. So if you've ever seen Inside the Actor's Studio with James Lipton, he has a list of questions he asks his different guests, and they're always the same. So this is my take on that. I've got 8 questions, starting with question number 1. Do you believe in ghosts? And if so, have you had any unexplainable or spooky stories?
So when I was younger, I absolutely believed in ghosts. Now I, you know, I'm open-minded to the possibility, but I don't particularly believe in them. I kind of have this theory that most ghost encounters are similar to what happens in the sensory deprivation tank. You go into this dark, haunted house, it's quiet in there, it's dark in there, you're not seeing much, and on top of that, you've kind of set this expectation that it's haunted and there's, you know, negative entities in there or whatever, so you're bound to feel or hear or see something. That said, I did have an experience that when I was younger made me think there were ghosts. I was sitting at my computer, my family had left the house, they'd gone out, and I'm just sitting there and there's this loud bang, and I have these like 3 steps that are like shelves as well, and I look over and everything that was on the shelves had fallen off. And at the time, you know, rather than explaining it as, you know, one thing's fallen off and knocked the others off, I was just like, okay, something weird is happening here. I went to check if all the windows and doors were closed, you know, in case it was a draft or something like that. They were in fact closed. And for a long time, I was convinced that, you know, there was someone in the room with me there. I was a bit spooked out when I was in there. But over time, I kind of came to the idea that, yeah, it's probably something fell off and knocked the other things off, and then I kind of blew it up out of proportion, as tends to happen with a lot of these kind of experiences.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. So you think that ghosts and ghostly experience or unexplainable experiences, they happen because the mind kind of like tricks, well, the mind tricks the mind,
yeah,
so to speak.
Basically.
Is that the only unexplainable story you've had? What's the best way to put this? So even if you don't believe in ghosts, sometimes you have a really weird experience like the one you've described there. Have you ever had any unexplainable stories which are not spooky in nature, and that you think back and you go, hang on, what just happened?
I did have a few of those Mandela effect things. Again, I don't particularly believe that there's anything fancy going on there. I think it's likely just how our memory works. But I have this distinct memory of seeing the Tiananmen Square video with the guy coming up to the tank and the tank actually running him over. Like, I can see what it looked like in my brain. And so I guess I, you know, put this together from 2 different things, maybe from the stories of people getting run over and the video or something. But that really, you know, messed with my head for a while.
I think that's quite a common one as well. So in terms of Mandela effects, I think that's up there. So I don't think you're alone in that one. The weird one that I've had, speaking about the Mandela effect, is that the whole reason it's called Mandela effect is because everybody remembers Nelson Mandela having a funeral. And I too remember that. And I don't think I was even alive when that was supposed to have happened, but I remember somewhere watching Nelson Mandela having his funeral.
Yeah.
And it's a weird thing. I do believe that it's just the way that your brain kind of stores information, but there's a glitch somewhere in your brain and it just remembers things wrong. But yeah, I've experienced a few occasions of that, mainly Nelson Mandela's funeral. Okay, so question number two. This is very apt being who you are. What has been your favorite dream?
Okay, so I have a lot of favorite dreams. So I'm going to go with my most recent favorite dream. And it's going to be something a bit atypical. It's not going to be what you'd usually expect to be a favorite dream because it was more of a nightmare, actually. A couple of nights ago, actually, this happened. I was in a dream and I was being chased by a murderer and I was escaping from the murderer. And as I was escaping, I became lucid. This is typical for me when I have scary dreams because I'm not particularly often chased by murderers in waking life. So I usually catch the fact that I'm dreaming. And for whatever reason, I just decided to keep going with it and keep running away from him. So I'm running away, escaping, and the dream is getting more and more scary as it goes on. And there comes a point where I just decide that actually, why am I running away? You know, it's fun to sometimes play along with a dream, but why don't I do the opposite? Why don't I actually turn around and face the scary things? You know, maybe this will help me in the real world, you know, facing fears and that. So I turned around and I started going after the murderer. I started chasing him around and he disappeared, but the dream scenery started getting spookier and like it was all dark around and I started hearing these kind of glitchy, it was like glitchy 8-bit music like you might get in some indie horror game. And I'm walking around, there's fog everywhere, I can't see where I'm going, but I can see, you know, creatures in the distance and I'm heading in that direction where the scariest stuff is. Every step I took, it felt like my fear was doubling. It felt like I was getting more and more afraid, but I just kept pushing through it. And it was like I was experiencing more fear than I'd ever experienced before, but I was able to just keep going further and further and take it. And I woke up from that and it kind of gave me this realization that fear, for example, is something like going to the gym. You know, you go to the gym and you lift heavier and heavier weights over time. The weights don't necessarily get lighter. Every time you add weight to the bar, it's going to be more challenging than last time, but you get better at pushing through it. And it kind of gave me this realization that fear is the same thing. And I just took a nice lesson away from it. So that was my favorite recent dream.
Hell, that's an epic dream. It sounds very similar to the kind of thing that Charlie Morley talks about, in which he faces his shadow self. Mm-hmm. He talks about that kind of thing. Maybe you and Charlie should have a conversation one day. It'd probably be quite interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, so question number three, what is your favorite word?
Okay, so I thought about this one for a while and, you know, in English, I'm not really sure I have a favorite word. There's lots of words that I like. So I'm going to actually go for a Polish word. I'm going to go for the word cisza, and I'm probably butchering the pronunciation of it. I can't really say it perfectly, but it means silence. And I just like the word. I like what it stands for and I like how it sounds.
That's odd. I was going to say, you don't come across as someone who's Polish.
I'm half Polish. My mum's side is Polish. Dad's side is English and grew up in England, but now live in Poland.
You live in Poland now?
Yeah.
See, I'm learning things about you, Matt. Amazing. So are you going to pick up the Polish language at all?
Well, I can speak it fluently, just I don't know the grammar rules and anything. I basically learned it from speaking to my mum. So
I'm
a conversation, but it's not very grammatically correct. A lot of people over here, they can't tell from my accent and they just think that I'm just a kind of stupid person that doesn't really, you know, didn't go to school or whatever.
Yeah, fair enough. I understand that. Okay. What's your favorite noise or sound?
I would have to probably say thunder or like raindrops when it's like a thundery storm outside, the raindrops on my roof. It's interesting as well because I kind of prefer like the summer in general and warmer weather, but the sounds during a storm are just something that I really like.
See, I get the feeling that when I do more and more of these podcasts, the favorite noise or sound is going to always be thunder or rain or something similar to that. That's what a lot of people... I find it interesting that your favorite word means silence, but your favorite noise is something quite...
Right,
thundery. Yeah. Quite interesting that. Okay, fifth question. If you could give yourself... Sorry, let's start that again. If you could give your younger self some advice, what would it be and how old would you be to talk to your younger self?
Okay, so I would say my younger self would probably be about 13 years old. And mm-hmm. I would tell them that, you know, when life isn't going very well and stuff like that, it's not just something that you're stuck with. You can work on it. You can improve it. Life isn't just like a slot machine where you just get a certain result and that's it. You know, you're dealt a hand in life and you can play it certain ways. So even if you're dealt a really bad hand, work on it, improve yourself, and things will get better. That would be my ultimate advice. And I would also tell him not to do drugs, because that was a very stupid several years of my life.
That's a pretty solid advice there, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Question number six. What are the top three things that are on your bucket list?
Okay. So the kind of generic one would be to travel the world. I especially want to visit the United States, and I also want to visit Israel and India, because my dad traveled to them when he was younger and he talked a lot about them and got me really curious about those countries. Another thing would be I want to speak in front of a live audience, because as someone with social anxiety, I feel like that's kind of the ultimate test, go in front of an audience and actually give a talk. And related to the last one, my kind of final big one is to not just defeat my social anxiety, but to overcome it to such a point that I'm outgoing and confident all the time.
Okay. That's three quite good bucket list things, I would say. You're quite open about the concept of you of social anxiety. And mm-hmm. I understand that from people I know personally, that they don't really like to talk about it. What's different about you speaking about it?
Yeah,
like you personally?
I've noticed that as well with other people with it. And for me, it all started when I opened up to one of my friends about the fact that I had social anxiety. At the time, I thought this was going to be a stupid decision, but I just opened up in the moment. And I found that after that, I was so incredibly comfortable around this person, which I'm normally not with 99% of people. And so I just started telling all of my friends about it, letting them know. And it kind of makes you comfortable, because when someone knows about it, they know that, you know, if you suddenly start feeling anxious and you just can't talk or you need some time alone or whatever, they already know. You don't have to explain anything in that moment. You can just look at them and say, not feeling it right now, and they'll understand. So I've kind of been open about it for that reason.
So you took the jump, the leap of faith in the right mm-hmm. person, importantly, and yeah. things just kind of took itself from there.
Mm-hmm.
That's quite interesting. I'm going to have to write that down somewhere. So it's a solid theory. So question number seven, what is your opinion on God?
Okay, so this is an interesting one. Okay, so I would say I believe in God, but perhaps not in the traditional sense. I believe in God as being the universe. I don't believe in God as being a person up in the clouds or whatever, or necessarily even a living entity in the traditional sense. I yeah. see God as just the totality of everything, because I have this view that we make things into arbitrary systems. You know, we say this is a person, this is a house, this is a plant or whatever. But I personally have the theory that we're all kind of connected. We're all part of the same system. And that system is what I think religions are referring to in reality when they're talking about God. I think it is just nature. It is the universe. And so in that sense, I believe in it. But I don't believe there's a dude in the clouds who's controlling everything and all that.
Yeah, I get the feeling that as my podcasts progress through time, I think that a lot of people are going to share your opinion, because a while back I had exactly the same opinion in which mm-hmm. everything is connected. I've actually got a video coming out next Monday, and I'm talking to my missus and we're discussing the concept of God. So that's quite good that I think that a lot of people who practice lucid dreaming have this opinion as well.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's something that's, you know, because of lucid dreaming, because everyone realizes that the whole concept of a lucid dream, something existing in the mind, you know, solely. I don't know if there's any link to that, but it'll be interesting to see down the line about that. Yeah. Okay. So my last question, question number 8, which could be linked to what we discussed previously about your YouTube channel in the future, but maybe not. Where do you see yourself in 5 years' time?
Okay, so obviously I don't know for sure where I'll be in 5 years' time, but where I would hope to be, I would hope to be living in the city. I'm currently living in a small town and I'd like to be somewhere with more people, so I'm kind of forced to be around people more, and there's more activities to do and stuff like that. I want to be putting out awesome content all of the time. I'm hoping to have written a few books or something, and basically I want to have my channel where I want it to be, with regards to it being a self-development channel and not just lucid dreaming. And I want to be in a better place with regards to fitness and stuff. You know, I want to be strong. I want to be, you know, working out regularly and all that. And I basically just want to be better each year. And so in a really awesome place in 5 years' time.
Do you write your goals down at all when you're talking about your 5 year plan? Is that something that you physically write down, or maybe a document on your Google Drive or something?
I have done. I have written some goals down. I don't write all of them down, but I tend to write down kind of my major goals. And I actually recently started this achievement journal thing. And it's basically just a diary that I write in every day. But anytime I achieve something cool, you know, whether it's a subscriber goal or, you know, I've written something cool, or I faced a fear or whatever, I put it in that diary so I can go back and see what I've achieved. But I also, every month, I look at my long-term goals. I look at, you know, where I want to be a couple of years from now. And then I look at how close I am to that based on my progress in the last month.
Okay, that's quite good to know. I used to write down every single goal that I wanted to do in the space of a year. And then I used to break that down into its like subdivisions, what I need to do to achieve that goal. And then I used to break those down into what do I need to do to achieve this bit so that I can achieve my goal. So I basically had a list of insane things. And when it comes to like goal setting, I know you need to make it achievable and realistic, you know, all the SMART principles stuff. But I really struggled with that. So I don't generally write down what I want to do, but I know that's kind of not good practice, so to speak.
I find that what can help is just, you know, not writing necessarily everything down, but writing the things down that are measurable. So for example, if you want to write a book that's this amount of length, then you can put down how many pages you want it to be and measure over time as you're getting closer and closer to that. That's something you can measure. So I would write that down. But if it's just something like, I want to be living a really awesome, happy life, I wouldn't necessarily write that down, because it's kind of just a given and I can't measure my progress on that so easily.
Yeah, I would say that's pretty solid advice. So that's it for the whole questions, and kind of concludes our talk that we've had today. Is there anything else that you want to talk to about? Do you want to plug anything that you're flogging at the moment? Now is your chance.
Well, I am working on a lucid dreaming book at the minute. I say this, it's possibly a long way off, because I do have a habit of kind of procrastinating when I'm working on big projects like that. Like, I will crank out half of it and then spend several months doing the next half. But I'm looking forward to that. I do think that is going to be really helpful to a lot of people. I'm trying to basically make a lucid dreaming book that like has everything in it, everything you need as a kind of handbook, you know, all the different techniques, understanding REM and stuff like that, all the different applications for lucid dreaming, different aspects of dream control. I basically want it to be a kind of one-stop book that someone can pick up and they don't necessarily need to pick up any others.
I understand that. I used to have the same kind of goal as well, but when I read Daniel Love's book called Are You Dreaming, I thought to myself, I can't write anything better than that, mm-hmm. like as concise and as researched and as well documented as he did in his book. So I'm in the process of writing a book as well. But it's, again, like yourself, I'm probably worse than you when it comes to procrastinating. So it's going to be years down the line yet. But it's, I kind of gave up on that idea of trying to write the one-stop lucid dream book, and I've kind of spread it so that it's more of a autobiography in regards to lucid dreaming. So how, what process I went through to lucid dream, that's kind of what I'm doing. Again, it's going to be years down the line because I'm lazy as it comes.
Yeah.
But yeah. Okay. So that's pretty much it for today. If you want to go over and support Matt's channel, you can go to youtube.com/Tifero, I assume.
Yep.
Yep. Link will be in the description box below. And I just want to say a big great thank you to Matt for being the first guest on this unknown entity that is my podcast, because I don't know how well it's going to go or anything like that. So thank you for being the guinea pig.
And thank you for having me.
That's no problem. As I said, links will be in the description box below. And like I said at the beginning, I would like to say a big great thank you to all the Patreon supporters. As I said, for $1 a month, they can get access to exclusive content, including this podcast and audio download a week before it appears on the channel. However, as I said at the beginning, this is the first, so it might take a little bit of higgery jiggery to get that going. If you want to be a part of it, then head over to patreon.com/GizEdwards and join the Gizzards there. Thank you, everyone, and I will see you whenever. Thank you very much, Matt.
Sweet.
Thanks, everyone. Click the subscribe button. Hit that bell to get notified each time I upload. There's my last video. Click it. Watch it. And there's my channel. Click that too. Cheers.